Hello everyone, and welcome to the Art Gallery of Ontario's virtual programs. Thank you to the Michael Young Family Foundation for its support. And here we have a photograph of the Art Gallery of Ontario. I know that some of you have visited the Art Gallery of Ontario before, but for those of you who have not visited, I do hope you have the chance when we are once again open to the public. Even though we're not together today, even though we're not in the building, we want to begin by thinking about the land on which the Art Gallery of Ontario has been built. So let's begin by looking at a land acknowledgement together. The land the Art Gallery of Ontario is on is Michisagig, Anishinaabe Territory, Mississauga. It is also governed by a treaty between the Mississauga of the Credit and the Canadian government. Toronto is Michisagig, Anishinaabe Territory. It has also been occupied by other Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and Wendat Confederacies. Hi everybody, my name is Laboni and I am an art educator at the Art Gallery of Ontario, but I am joined today by two very special people who are both conservators at the AGO. Maria and Meaghan, could you introduce yourselves and please tell us what do conservators do?
Thank you, Laboni. Good morning. My name is Maria Sullivan and I am the head of conservation in the Michael and Sonia Kerner Center for Conservation at the AGO.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Meaghan Monaghan, and I am a painting conservator here at the Art Gallery of Ontario. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we do as conservators. So conservation is the care and protection of cultural objects. And as caretakers of collections, conservators examine, research, clean, and repair artworks. So we also try to prevent deterioration and damage. The team here works with mount makers, framers, curators, and the installation team very closely. And we all collaborate to ensure that the artworks in our collection look their best today and also for generations.
Thank you so much, Maria and Meaghan. We are so excited for this conversation and to be sharing it with everybody out there in the audience today. Welcome, welcome. So today, Maria and Meaghan are going to take us on a journey. We are going to look at three paintings together, and we're going to explore the color blue. Let's begin by giving you just a glimpse of the three paintings that we're going to see today. And remember, I'm only showing you one small part of a larger painting, so you can use your imaginations to think about what the rest of the scene might look like. There we go. These are three glimpses at the three paintings that we're going to look at today. And what's really important here is that Maria, Meaghan, and I want this to feel like a conversation. So sometimes we're going to ask you questions, and we would be so happy if you would put your answers in the Q&A, and we will share aloud as many as we can. So here's a question to start things off. What are some different types of blue that you can name? Also, how do you think these blue colors or blue pigments have been made in the past, or how do you think they're made today? Please put your ideas in the Q&A. Oh my goodness, they're coming in already. Somebody says sky blue, light blue, indigo. Keep your answers coming. Someone says maybe they are made from gems or rocks. Maybe they're made from plants. Somebody out there knows the color cyan, ultramarine, ocean blue, royal blue, navy blue, turquoise, which is one of my favorite colors. Thank you, everybody. Another person suggests maybe they would use minerals and bind them together with a binder like fish gelatin. Cerulean and teal are some other colors that you've named. A nice, elegant color. I agree. I do find blue to be very elegant and also calming. We're going to think about the relationship between color and mood towards the end of today's session. Thank you, everybody, for your responses. So, Maria, could you tell us a little bit more about the various kinds of blue that exist in these paintings, as well as how they have been made in the past or how they may be made today?
Thanks, Laboni. Could we go live to our conservation studio, please?
Here we go.
Great, thank you. So as Laboni mentioned, we're going to focus today on some historic blue pigments, and I have some lovely colors here. I have an ultramarine. This is a light ultramarine. This is an ultramarine blue, a cobalt blue. And so some of you named some of these. This is a cerulean blue, so some really lovely colors and sort of a real variety as well. This one is a Prussian blue, Egyptian blue. We only have a tiny bit of that one. And this is a more modern blue, a phthalo or phthalocyanine blue. Most of the earliest pigments were made from rocks and minerals found in the earth and ground into small particles that could be used to make paint. So earth and minerals can be different colors. They can be blue, but they can also be like a yellow, like this beautiful yellow ochre from France, or this beautiful red earth from Italy. So just a wide variety of colors. Pigment could also be made from the burned remains of bones or wood, like this vine black. So burning materials was a great way to make black pigments. Artists or their assistants would have used a mortar or pestle, mortar and pestle. So that's like this. You might have one like this in your kitchen or maybe even in your science labs. And they would grind the pigment to make it into the, you know, however coarse or fine they wanted it, mix it to the right degree. They might have used a muller like this. And they would use that on a plate to grind the pigment together with a binder. And that's really important because the binder and the pigment need to be very well mixed in order to get the full effect of the color. And so that was a really important part of the process. Preparing pigments was really time consuming. So Laboni, could we go to our next slide, please?
Absolutely, here we go.
Great, perfect. So this is a timeline of blue pigments and shows historical blue pigments and when they have been used. So Egyptian blue, which is a copper calcium silicate, was one of the earliest blue colors available. It was made by heating copper, calcium, and silica-containing material together to a very high heat. Azurite and ultramarine, the earliest forms of both of these pigments, were made from naturally occurring minerals and rocks that were ground to fine particles to be used in paint. Later, they were synthesized chemically. Azurite was first manufactured in the 17th century and ultramarine starting in 1826. Prussian blue was accidentally discovered by a color maker in Berlin in 1704 when he was experimenting with the oxidation states of iron. Iron chloride solution mixed with potassium ferrocyanide created a blue precipitate, and the solid matter was Prussian blue. And it was available to artists starting around 1724. Smalt is a blue pigment that was made from cobalt blue glass, used mainly from the 15th to the 18th century. And then we have some later pigments like cobalt blue, which is a cobalt oxide, aluminum oxide, first used in 1802, and cerulean blue, which is a cobalt stannate, used in the 1860s for the first time. And then even more modern blues, like a phthalo or phthalocyanine blue, first used in 1935, and one that was discovered very recently in 2009 by accident in a chemistry lab, yin min blue, which is a mixture of yttrium, iridium, and manganese.
Wow, that is incredible. Thank you so much, Maria. It's just amazing for me to listen to this and to see all of those pigments in the containers, because I never really think about the amount of work that goes into the making of a color before painting can even begin. So speaking of paintings, let's take a look at our first painting together. Here we go, and what a beauty it is. So for everyone in the audience, when you look at this painting, what is your first response or reaction to the image? Please put your ideas in the Q&A. I'm just going to wait for them to come in. All right, so a couple people are saying there's a very nice dress. We're going to come back to that in a moment. The person looks royal. There is some kind of white flower. These are wonderful observations. Keep them coming. Someone says the background looks fake. Her dress texture is well captured. The painting looks very grand. There are vivid and luxurious colors. Thank you, everybody, for your responses. Now, this painting is actually shrouded in a lot of mystery. So it features a woman of color wearing a blue silk dress, detailed with lace. She's standing outdoors, but we don't know exactly where in the world she is. And with her right hand, she is holding an orange blossom. Somebody has mentioned there's lots of jewelry. Yes, there is. And some of her dress looks translucent. So just to clarify that word for everyone in the audience, if something is opaque, that means we cannot see through it. It does not let any light through. If something is transparent, we can see through it. It lets light through. If something is translucent, it's in between. It lets some light through and we can kind of see through it. So thank you for those descriptive words. Now, based on this woman's clothing and the jewelry, it suggests that she is a person of wealth and status. After all, she is having her portrait being made. We believe that the painter of this portrait would have been somebody likely born in Europe and trained in the European painting style. We also believe that this painting would have been made in the mid to late 1700s. Now just think about that date for a moment and think about the color timeline that Maria just shared with us so beautifully. We're going to start a poll. I'm just going to wait for the poll to pop up. Here we go. Based on the date of this painting, mid to late 1700s, what blue pigment do you think the artist used? Do you believe it was azurite, ultramarine, Prussian blue, cobalt blue, or cerulean blue? Please vote for the answer that you believe in, and we are going to wait for your votes to come in. And while the votes come in, I'm just going to plant one question in both of your heads. It came through from the audience. Someone was wondering, were any of these pigments dangerous or toxic to use? And we don't need to answer that now, but maybe we can come back to it at an appropriate time in the conversation. All right, the votes are coming in. Let's see. Okay, so first thing I can tell you, all of the five choices received votes. I'm going to start with fifth place. In fifth place, with the fewest votes, we have azurite. In fourth place, with a few more votes, we have cobalt blue. And then tied for, I guess, third, second, or first place, we have ultramarine, cerulean blue, and Prussian blue. So based on the votes, it sounds like people were pretty undecided. Maria, from your perspective, what do you think would have been used and how did you come to that conclusion?
Yeah, those are, that's a great poll and really interesting to see the responses. They were all great guesses. So in this case, as conservators, we would actually try to make an educated guess about what blue pigment was used. I think we could probably rule out ultramarine because ultramarine at this time was such a costly and precious pigment. It's unlikely that it would have been used for such a large area. It would have been in just enormously expensive. Smalt and azurite might be good possibilities. They were both available at that time. Cerulean blue and cobalt blue actually weren't available to artists yet. So that would be a little bit of a problem if we found them in this painting. So I think they are very unlikely. And a likely guess is also Prussian blue, which was first available to artists starting in 1724. And it was incredibly popular in the 18th century. If we want to know exactly what pigment was used, we'd actually have to undertake scientific analysis. We haven't managed to pursue that yet with this painting, but it's something that we look forward to doing and finding out more about exactly what pigments were used. But Meaghan has some examples to share where we have pursued scientific investigation.
Thanks so much, Maria. It really sounds like conservators do a lot of detective work. And there's this beautiful blending of art and science. So for anyone in the audience who is both artistically and scientifically spirited, consider the area of conservation as a potential career. So when I see blue in a painting, all I really see is the color blue. But Meaghan, how do you figure out the precise pigments that an artist has used?
So if we could go live to the conservation studio again, I'm sitting here surrounded by a painting and a microscope. A microscope is a tool we use a lot in conservation. And so as Saloni said, when she sees blue, she sees the color blue, and we all mentioned a lot of blue colors, but pigments, blue pigments, actually, there's a wide variety of hues in each blue pigment. So it could be indigo, but it might be slightly different, you know, light blue, dark blue, depending. So we need some more tools to find out what is really there. So one thing we can do, and Maria mentioned this maybe, is like take really small samples. So I'm gonna try my best to show you this. They are very small, so it might be hard to see. But when we take a sample of a painting, it's this tiny dot that you see. It's the size of a period, let's say, on a piece of paper. And we'll take a little piece of paint like that from, we try to do it from an edge, or sometimes if there's a damage, we can take a tiny scraping off the edge of the damage. And we then look at that under a microscope. And here I've also got another example of what this indigo pigment can look like when it hits a pigment. So it's really a very fine powder. So we put these under the microscope, though, and start to see a lot of details. And so pick it up the next slide.
Absolutely.
I've got two of the pigments that Maria mentioned and what they look like under the microscope. So on the left side, you have Prussian blue, which Maria mentioned is created through a reaction with iron. And it creates a very fine pigment that can clump together into these shapes that you see under the microscope, and they are opaque. So actually Loboni mentioned this earlier, so you can't see through them. They clump together, they're so fine and they're a bit soft. On the right side, you can see azurite, which looks quite different under the microscope because it's made through grinding. You can see that it has sharp edges. It's sort of varied in size. There's some bigger particles, there's some smaller particles, and also is slightly translucent, so you can see through some of the particles. So this is one way we can distinguish between two particles under the microscope. Another way to think about identifying different pigments is by looking at their chemical structure. So I put the chemical structures of these pigments underneath their names, and I'm sure some of you are taking some chemistry courses, maybe. We might be able to take a guess here. So Prussian blue is made with iron. Azurite is also an oxidized metal. And so if we could put a poll, I wanted to ask you if you could guess which metal azurite is made from. There we go. There's the poll. So your options are cobalt, aluminum, or copper. Let's see what everybody guesses. As we're waiting for the poll to come in, I'll just also mention that paintings, after they're made, they're always undergoing changes as they age. And so it's important for us to understand what chemicals are present so we can understand what chemical reactions are occurring. So that's also a great thing. Oh, and you know what I could also just put in here is that someone asked about if pigments are dangerous. And yes, there's sort of two reasons why a pigment can be dangerous. Very fine particles can be easily breathed into your lungs, and that's quite dangerous. So you always have to make sure that you're wearing a mask if you're dealing with really fine particles so that you don't breathe them in. Another thing is that the chemicals present, so sometimes the metals that are present can be poisonous. So you have lead, for example, which is poisonous. So do we have the results of the poll yet? Okay, so Laboni, do you want to say the results or do you want me to?
I'm happy either way.
Okay, I'll say them. So it looks like in third place we have cobalt, then in second place aluminum, and in first place copper. So it looks like you guys know your chemical formulas. Copper is correct. So as it's created through the oxidation or the addition of oxygen of copper.
Thank you so much, Meaghan. I'm sorry I interrupted you. Keep going.
Nope, I was about to say that you can go to the next slide.
Oh, perfect. Wonderful. Thank you so much, Meaghan. And I have to say, I am super impressed by everyone in the audience because as soon as I saw these chemical formulas, it was like a flashback to grade 10 science or grade 11 chemistry. And I remember we had to memorize the first 20 or 30 elements of the periodic table. So we were all coming up with these mnemonic devices and songs to help us remember. So good for you, everyone out there. Let's take a look at a work of art that connects to all of this information. And could I have one of my colleagues just send me a quick message in the chat to reactivate it? All right, we'll just wait for that to come in. Thank you so much. Okay, it looks like the chat isn't popping up. That's okay. We'll reactivate that a little bit later. So let's take a look at our second painting. And this is a painting by Jan Steen. And the painting is called A Village Festival. A Village Festival. So I want you to take a look at the painting from top to bottom and from side to side. And just think about how would you describe the sky or the weather in this scene. Please put your ideas in the Q&A, and I'm gonna see if I can bring up the answers once again. So you can go ahead and put your answers in the Q&A. I'm gonna stop share for a moment, and then I will return to the painting. And we'll just see if we can reactivate it. Here we go. Thanks, everybody. Okay, we are back. The wonders of technology. Okay, so the responses are flying in. People say it looks cloudy. It looks very dark. It looks rainy. It looks dreary. It looks like it's about to rain. It looks brooding. It looks stormy, very cloudy, so much like today. And it looks scary. So I noticed that in none of your responses was the word beautiful or sunshiny. Everybody agrees that the weather looks slightly ominous. In fact, someone has just said the sky looks threatening and somber. Now, this is a little peculiar, isn't it? Because the painting is called A Village Festival, but nobody here seems particularly concerned about the gray, overcast sky. Meaghan, I know that you have been working on this piece. Can you tell us a little bit more about your conservation work and what you have discovered?
Absolutely, it would be my pleasure. So this painting was treated by our Kerner Conservation Fellow, Stephanie Barnes, I think it's almost a few years ago. And what she was doing was cleaning the painting. And so when we clean a painting, we often are removing some dirt from the surface and also sometimes old varnish that's discolored. So at that time, we noticed the sky looked a bit cloudy and we thought, well, maybe once we clean it, it'll look a little bit brighter. But first, before we could start the conservation treatment, always want to know what materials are present. Because as I was talking about the chemical reactions that can occur with these materials, we want as much knowledge about the materials present so we know how to best approach the painting. So what Stephanie did was she took a little tiny sample like that one I showed you from some areas of the blue sky. And she took one from an area that looked a little bit lighter blue and one that looked a little bit darker yellow green. And if we can go to the next slide, I can show you those samples. So these are cross sections of those tiny samples under the microscope. On the left side, I didn't mention this earlier, but we send the samples to the Canadian Conservation Institute, which is a scientific research center in Ottawa. And they have a lot of techniques they can use, imaging and chemical analysis techniques. And so when they looked at the two particles that are identified as one and two in the sample on the left, they found the materials cobalt, silica, and potassium. And so we know that that is smalt. That's the glass pigment that Maria mentioned earlier in the talk. So it's a cobalt-colored glass, and glass and silica go hand in hand. So that's how smalt was identified. And that sample is actually from an area that was a little bit lighter, brighter. The sample on the right was from the area where things looked a little bit darker and grayer. And so here, you can see there's azurite pigment particles at the top layer of that, and they still look blue. But what they found was the small particles in this area, which are pointed to, are not blue anymore. They're actually gray. And this is a really common situation that happens, especially when smalt is in foil. So over time, a chemical reaction happens between the oil and the smalt particles. And the potassium leaches out into the oil and along with it, the color. And so slowly it goes from blue to gray. And so we now know that is part of the reason why the sky looks more stormy and gray.
That is incredible. Thank you so much, Meaghan. And here we go once again, chemistry and art. So the reason nobody seems particularly concerned about the sky is because originally that sky probably looked a lot more blue and the weather probably looked a whole lot better. There's one question that's come up here. Would you paint it to go back to the artist's intention? I don't know if you want to answer that question now or maybe later on towards the end. How do you feel?
Just say quickly that we wouldn't do that in this case, but sometimes what we do is create a digital reconstruction so that we can give people an idea of what it may have looked like previously.
That's wonderful. Thank you. And thank you to whoever in the audience posed that question. An excellent one. So some of you out there are probably art students. Maybe you have a box of art supplies. So in some cases, we actually have proof of the pigments that artists used because they left behind some of their supplies, or in this case, a paint box. So here is one example, and this is a paint box that belonged to a Canadian artist, a Canadian painter named Kathleen Munn. Maria, could you tell us a little bit more about this paint box and the connection to your work?
Yes, thank you, Liboney. So Toronto artist Kathleen Munn lived from 1887 to 1974 and wasn't very well known in her time, but was very well admired by fellow artists. The AGO is very lucky to have a strong collection of Munn's paintings and papers, as well as this paint box. This is like a treasure chest for conservators and conservation scientists. It gives us an opportunity to learn a lot more about the paints and materials that she was using. As part of a major research project, Kerner Conservation Fellow Stephanie Barnes looked closely at all these materials, and we collaborated with a scientist at the Canadian Conservation Canadian Conservation Institute to determine the exact composition of the paints and how they relate to the pigments used in Munn's paintings. Can we go to the next slide, Leboni? So here you see the various blue paints used by Munn. And the scientists were able to analyze the elements present in each paint to confirm the blue pigments. Do you recognize some of the chemicals, some of the elements mm-hmm. listed in this chart? You can see that the first tube contains ultramarine, which is a sulfur-containing sodium silicate. So you can see that there's sodium there, silicon, you see the S for sulfur. The second tube is a cobalt blue, and you can see that there's aluminum, cobalt, oxygen, because it's a cobalt oxide, aluminum oxide. And the third is a cerulean blue, which is a cobalt stannate, which contains tin. And you can see Sn is the element for tin. So this painting by Munn of a seated woman in profile was painted around 1910. The sleeves and dress of the woman are beautiful, deep blue. Can you guess which blue this might be? It's a blue that was used extensively by Munn and was found in her paint box. Thanks to scientific analysis by the Canadian Conservation Institute, we know exactly which blue this is, and it's ultramarine. Thanks, Leboni.
Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you so much, Maria and Meaghan, and also for taking us on a tour of Kathleen Munn's paint box. What's neat here is that there are so many different shades of blue in this painting, and that really shapes the mood or the feeling that the painting gives you, which is something that one of you mentioned much earlier in the session. For thank you for that. All right, so let's take again a look at our blue journey, or our journey through blue. Today, Maria and Meaghan have shown us the portrait of a lady holding an orange blossom, a village festival, and last but not least, a portrait of a seated woman by Kathleen Munn. Maria, Meaghan, thank you so much for your time and for sharing your knowledge, and basically an insider's look at all of the art and the chemistry that happens behind the scenes at the AGO. And thank you for everyone in the audience for your participation, your questions and connections. We all hope that you stay safe and stay creative, and we hope we can spend some more time together very soon. Bye, everybody.